To the International Conference of World Languages and Literatures Conference. Now we are so privileged to have Professor Rodney Johns, a distinguished scholar in digital literacy, language embodiment, broadly social linguistics of language and its relation to culture, communities, and ethnicity, and more. Personally, I have, It's just like many scholars, I have used his books for a long time, and I have a great insight and valuable insights into many research. And I think so many people will agree with this idea. So we are so happy to have him as a keynote speaker at this conference, and we are fully ready to listen to his recent journey into the mediation of language in video sharing platform and its use of the representing culture and the community and identity, things like that, in a new digital media platform. Let's welcome Professor Rodney Johns to this keynote speak.
Thank you very much, Sunyoung. That's very kind of you. Thank you for the very kind introduction. I'm just going to share my screen now. Is my screen visible?
Yeah, that's perfect.
Everybody?
That's perfect. We could see it properly. Well.
Okay, That's great. So thank you to the organizers for asking me to speak at this really interesting conference. I'm very pleased to be here. What I'm going to do today is talk about some of the things that we as scholars of language and literature can learn from the way people use the popular video sharing platform called TikTok. Since I'm a sociolinguist, I'll mainly be focusing on how TikTok and other platforms like it change the ways people can use language to manage their social lives. But I expect many of the issues that I'll touch on in this discussion will also be of interest to people working in a wide range of other disciplines in literature and languages. Issues like identity, style, embodiment, affect, cultural appropriation, racism, homophobia. Most of all, what I want to argue is that the technological affordances of TikTok provide opportunities for users to reflect upon and act on these issues in new ways. I should warn you at the outset that some of the material I'll be sharing depicts behavior that may make some people uncomfortable in terms of sort of mocking and stereotyping various racial, ethnic, gender, sexual groups. And so I just want to alert you to that before I start. So like many fields in the humanities and social sciences, there's been an increasing emphasis in sociolinguistics on notions of embodiment, not just how people use the body to express and comprehend linguistic meaning, but also how people experience language and communication as embodied practices. In a 2016 article that is now well known in the field, Mary Buckles and Kira Hall called for the development of an embodied sociocultural linguistics, which refocuses our attention on how bodies produce language and how language produces bodies in ways that challenge traditional sociolinguistic understandings of things like identity, indexicality, and agency. Unfortunately, it's been sociolinguists of digital media like me that have been relatively slow in taking up this call, most of us focusing primarily on the semiotic dimensions of digital communications. But as Buckles and Hall point out, even as technologically mediated forms of communication may seem to displace physical bodies as sources of linguistic production, the body insistently reasserts itself in communicative practices in the spheres of technology and the media. This has been particularly obvious in the last 5 years, or so, as the body has become a much more salient resource for communication in digital media in the context of things like selfies, video conferencing, and virtual reality, as well as the embodied performances of users of video sharing platforms like TikTok. For those of you less familiar with TikTok, it's a short-form video sharing platform originally launched in China in 2016 by a company called ByteDance. In 2017, ByteDance bought Musical.ly, a video platform that allowed users to create short lip sync and comedy videos. And in 2018, the two applications were merged. The app has been downloaded over a billion times outside of China, making it the seventh most downloaded app in the last decade. People use it to create videos on a range of topics. You typically find things like funny sight gags. Magic tricks. Instructional videos and tutorials.
Hash browns are for wimps. You can do better. We're making a potato galette.
And of course, the most popular kinds of videos are dance videos. And the kinds of videos that I'm going to be most concerned with in this talk, that is lip syncing videos. I think we got a winner. People want to dap it up, but they can't get none from it. I went to jail and snap it up. At least I had bum money. People want to walk around me trying to steal my lingo. The interface for making these videos is extremely user-friendly, but packed with a range of powerful features that allow users to choose from a library of soundtracks that include both commercial music and soundtracks of other users' videos, to add different filters, video effects, text, emojis, and of course, hashtags. Most importantly, to slow down the music track or speed up the video recording to better sync moves, gestures, and lip syncing to the music. The viewing interface has icons for users to follow the creator of the video, to like the video, to comment, to share it on other social media platforms, and crucially, here to see other videos that have used this soundtrack and to reuse the soundtrack in other videos. So really the key practice this app allows, at least the one I think is most interesting to sociolinguists like me, is that of appropriating and recontextualizing sounds from one video to another, creating these mimetic chains of appropriation and reappropriation of different people's voices. TikTok's often referred to as a social media platform, and it is intensely social, but in many ways, it doesn't really conform to Boyd and Ellison's famous definition of a social network site. It's not about creating a bounded network of friends. People are connected more by the voices and soundtracks that they reappropriate, the trends they participate in, and the challenges they take up. Ethan Briesnick calls it an experimental audiovisual playground full of digital play equipment that people engage with in embodied ways. But TikTok's not just about play. It's also gained a reputation as a site of youth activism, with, for example, K-pop fans on TikTok spamming the hashtag White Lives Matter, and with videos of Korean boy bands, progressive TikTokers in the US organizing mass false registrations for Trump rallies, resulting in empty seats, and the amplification on TikTok of footage of police brutality, as well as scenes and commentary from Black Lives Matter protests around the world. But there's also a flip side of this, with TikTok also serving as a platform for white supremacist discourse, anti-LGBTQ hate speech, and all sorts of everyday acts of symbolic violence and cultural appropriation. What I want to argue in this talk is that the root of much of both the racism and the anti-racism, both the hate speech and the social activism on TikTok, are the linguistic and metalinguistic practices that the platform makes possible with its unique technological affordances. Affordances which facilitate what Betsy Rhimes calls citizen sociolinguistics, the process of ordinary people reflecting on, evaluating, and debating the embodied linguistic practices of themselves and other. the most important affordance that facilitates this reflective stance towards language and identity is what I call synthetic embodiment, which is actually, in my view, a central affordance of all digital media. It's the ability that digital media give to people to fabricate new forms of embodiment by mixing and remixing different modes, media, and materialities. Examples include the avatars people create in virtual worlds, digitally enhanced Snapchat pictures, and Animoji. Synthetic embodiment is also intimately associated with the kinds of identity work that's long been of interest to sociolinguists, in which people draw on multiple semiotic resources in order to orient themselves to particular gendered, racialized, classed, and sexualized ideas, and to enact particular kinds of authenticities. These resources include forms of language, gesture, artifacts, hairstyles, settings, arranged in configurations of emblematic or recognizable features. An example of this can be seen in the TikTok profile here of Charlie D'Amelio, the world's most followed TikTok creator, whose videos in some way embody the ideal feminine subject of the contemporary post-feminist neoliberal cultural context. Normatively feminine, white, wealthy, cute but edgy, conventional yet woke, right down to the Black Lives Matter slogan as her profile picture, an embodiment that fits into the broader template of identities offered up by what the TikTok algorithm marks as trending. It can be argued that synthetic embodiment is, by its very nature, an exercise in caricature, a matter of, as Copeland puts it, packaging up stylistic and socio-semantic complexes and making them transportable. They are iterations, repetitions, bundles of quotation, infiltrated by, and in turn infiltrating, the orders of indexicality of the environments in which they're formed. This caricature manifests in sometimes subtle and sometimes not so subtle ways. In a very interesting study about the way people use Animoji, for instance, Susan Herring and her colleagues found speaking through Animoji filters seems to encourage playful verbal performances of stereotyped characters and persona. 85% of the Animoji clips in their corpus involve deviations from normal voice qualities of the performer, and many of these performances included the stylization of ethnic and regional accents linked in sometimes racist ways to particular Animoji figures. Here's some examples from their data from a series of Animoji performances of fictional medical students.
Just a little safety tip for anyone who matched at Hopkins. It is in a ghetto, okay? I am telling you, the match day was very, 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 very stressful because, as you know, you can tell by the complexion, I am a foreign medical graduate.
So TikTok, as well, as I'll show you later, contains plenty of examples of users imitating stereotypical voices, mannerisms, dress, and makeup styles of particular ethnicities, classes, sexualities, in ways that perpetuate cliches. Where we see similar issues of styling and caricature in TikTok is in the act of lip syncing, in which the appropriation of the voices of other people is not just an aesthetic choice, but often takes on social and even political dimensions. My interest in the voice is not just because I'm a linguist, but because of the interesting way TikTok unsettles the relationship between body and voice, creating opportunities for us to think about how voices speak to, from, and of embodied subjects, how voices don't just convey or express meaning, but how they create and disturb social identities and political subjectivities. The relationship between the body and the voice is already fragile. On the one hand, it's grounded in the body and linked to particular ways of using the body and particular types of people and to the uniqueness of particular people. The body creates the voice, and in some respects, the voice creates the body. It locates the body in physical and social space as being of a particular kind. At the same time, the voice has its own free floating materiality. As Jacob Bird puts it, the central identity of voice is that it's both self and other, subject and object, and that in each act of voicing, the speaker is at the same time the listener. The voice is also what links us to our social worlds. It doesn't just exceed subjects, it interconnects them. Embodied voices are also always mediated by culture. Notions of gender, ethnicity, and race, they don't just represent those cultural characteristics, they also enact them. Mary Buckles talks about how the development of communication technologies, such as the phonograph, the telephone, and the sound film, and more recently, digital media, have produced dramatic shifts in language and subjectivity by facilitating the separation of the voice from the body. The governing ideologies of voice under earlier stages of modernity were rooted in essentialization and authentication, which comfortably imposes and reasserts hegemonic ideologies of subjectivity. By contrast, in the media regimes of the late modern period, now, already essentialized voices have become further recontextualized through a process of linguistic re-embodiment, whereby such voices are detached from explicably raced, gendered, and classed bodies, and jarringly reassigned to inappropriate bodies via language crossing and stylization. Many of the representations produced under this technological regime serve to either unsettle or restore these earlier essentialist notions about the connection between the right voice and the right body. And it's this interplay between unsettling and restoring essentialist identities that's at the heart of lip syncing, especially as it's practiced in genres like drag. The appropriation of the voice of another simultaneously opens up new communicative possibilities, the fakeness of the performance. What makes drag enjoyable is the queering of the voice-body relationship, not just the entrainment of the performer's lips to the voice of the other, but the way they're entangled, always on the edge of fighting against each other, the mislocated wrongness of the voice. However skillful the performance is, there's always a gap, which is describable, and from this gap emerges all kinds of effective possibilities. The style of the embodied performer mingling with the appropriated voice, generating what Bell calls symbolically condensed dialogues between the self and other. This gap may arise when the body syncing the voice and the voice being synced are perceptibly of different biological sexes, as is often the case in drag, and also often the case in TikTok.
What's wrong with your arm?
Oh, nothing. I just got the new COVID vaccine. I got a text this morning. Said
the game, while you were just my con. If my homie got a girl, tell his ass to put me on. If I said I want your bitch, baby, I get what I want.
You can see also in these examples, there are also examples of not just the gender being different from the body, but also the racial or ethnic identity being different from the body. In sociolinguistics, we're accustomed to thinking of stylization as the mannered adoption of another's voice. But here in TikTok, the locus of stylization is not the voice, it's the body. Specifically, the embodiment of the voice. In many ways, the effects are the same, the projection of a particular recognizable persona into the performance of another in a way which, as Bakhtin inserts, is inherently multi-voiced, containing varying degrees of otherness and varying degrees of our ownness, and carrying with them their own evaluative tone, which we assimilate, rework, and re-accentuate. These embodied stylizations are also evident in non-lip-syncing videos, especially those which depict users' transformation from one embodied style to another, such as the karma is a bitch challenge, where users perform a switch from a nerdy persona to a glamorous one. Just as with the linguistic stylization, these embodied stylization tend to rehearse well-worn lines of indexicality drawn from familiar sociocultural repertoires ripe with ideological values. In this case, based on characological figures of gendered heteronormative attractiveness. But when it comes to lip-syncing videos, the important thing to remember is that these embodied stylizations are often based on already stylized performances with their own repertoires of moves and mannerisms. This is particularly the case with commercial soundtracks.
Shorty a little baddie, she my little bull thing.
And so they function as displays of users' awareness of existing cultural texts and the value of being able to skillfully recontextualize them. And so the styles of celebrities provide resources for claiming a kind of cultural competence, the ability to disassemble and reassemble off-the-shelf indexical bundles, while at the same time reinforcing the indexical relationship between certain styles, certain social meanings, and triggering further repetition and quotation. This is, of course, not new to TikTok, and in some ways, it's the essence of fandom, the stickiness of certain voicings and mannerisms, catchphrases, styles of dress, of hair, and makeup. The same process, of course, is evident in anti-fandom, where mimicry of the voices of celebrities becomes an act of resistance.
When we hit the body with a tremendous, whether it's ultraviolet or just very powerful light, and I think you said that hasn't been checked, but you're going to test it. And then I said, supposing you brought the light inside the body, you can, which you can do either through the skin or in some other way.
The main point is that voice appropriation always involves what Jürgen Spitzmaler has referred to as meta-pragmatic stance-taking, in which animators of other voices position themselves as aligning to or distancing themselves from certain people or certain types of people.
When we hit the body.
And when this voice gets taken up by others, they recontextualize it, layering onto this voice their own storylines and their own embodied styles that don't entirely abandon the style of the original, but build new indexicalities. Marjorie Goodwin and this can also be seen, this kind of stylization can also be seen in the performance of non-lip-sync TikTok videos, which mediated performances are also highly stylized and exhibit a kind of heightened reflexivity towards the language being used, a kind of queering of the voice, which, as Butler notes, has the effect of turning language back onto itself.
One thing I don't think I will ever understand is when I go through a girl's comment section and her makeup, 10 out of 10, yeah? And then someone comments something like, one wipe, it's all gone. No shit, Sherlock, it's called makeup, you can wipe it off. And the second thing, when they say something like, catfish, it will be gone. Catfish, you don't look the same. Hello? I don't spend time and hours to look the same. Hello? Use your common sense. Do you think I put on makeup to look the same?
So here the creator stylizes her face, which is already enhanced with a filter, with exaggerated expressions and highlights, but also highlights through the text on the screen the stylization of her voice with this kind of multicultural London English, with the textual renderings of this linguistic variety becoming apparent. And then this voice gets taken up by others who layer and build upon this voice their own stories, their own styles, and their own identities.
One thing I don't think I will ever understand is when I go through a girl's comment section and her makeup 10 out of 10, yeah? And someone comments something like...
So Marjorie Goodwin and Samuel Lean have introduced the term transmodal stylization, by which they mean more than just forms of multimodal embodied styling, but modes of stance taking that are enacted when different communicative modalities simultaneously index multiple yet mutually elaborating culturally salient representations. Often these take the form of chains of recontextualization that operate a bit like image macro memes, each person who takes up the voice adding to it their own creative twist. A good example of this can be seen in the reappropriation and reworking of the voice and mannerisms of the famous kombucha girl.
It really smells like a public restroom. It smells like a public restroom. You know what? It smells like a public restroom. You know what? No. Well, it smells like a public restroom. You know what? No.
What Goodwin and Aleem emphasize with the idea of transmodal stylization is how, rather than bringing different indexical meanings or cultural references together into a neat, recognizable package, different kinds of references can become entangled in sometimes messy ways, especially as stylizations move across different media. As an example, let me take a meme which was a subject of a paper in the Journal of Sociolinguistics by my colleague Erhan Aslan and his collaborator Camila Vasquez. It started with this clip of a girl on the Dr. Phil show engaged in this kind of tough girl stylization.
Ain't nobody gonna catch me.
Cause you're too streetwise?
Yup. And all these hoes laughing like so funny.
And this later got turned into various image macro memes, spawning more memes. Right, but then it ended up being turned into a TikTok audio meme and ended up in the mouth of Muslim drag queens.
That's what I always do, and they never catch me. Ain't nobody gonna catch me.
Because you're too streetwise?
Yup. And all these hoes laughing like so funny.
You might still be able to untangle indexicality here, but it gets a bit harder with the introduction of Japanese cosplay.
Catch me outside, how about that?
Catch you outside? What does that mean?
What I just said.
Catch her outside and she'll go outside and do what she has to do.
At this point, it actually becomes difficult to trace neat lines of indexical relationships and unravel how all the fields of connotation cohere. What seems more important than indexicality here is iconicity. The iconicity of the performance, the way it plays with its resemblance with, and its utter lack of resemblance with the original. It's no doubt already occurred to you how these performances of multimodal and transmodal crossing can raise anxieties around not just aesthetic, but also ethical understandings of what Buchholz calls the right voice that goes with the right body. Indeed, many of these crossings clearly cross a line of what we might consider appropriate, such as the notorious Chavchek challenge, in which middle-class teenagers in the UK adopt the stereotype persona of chavs, a term used for uncouth working class people, both in their embodied and in their linguistic performances, or a video like this of a white middle class kid mimicking a poor person in Atlanta. Even Charli D'Amelio's hooded hip hop sings, like this one, in which she steals the lingo from the rapper Buck Nasty, at least skirt the line between symbolic appreciation and symbolic appropriation.
I think we got a winner. People want to dap it up, but they can't get none from it. I went to jail and snap it up, at least I had bum money. People want to rock around me, trying to steal my lingo. Just make sure when you talk about me, you say you're doing this thing, though.
Yeah. Sociolinguists have long been interested in various offline forms of voice appropriation, from Ramtin's description of how London teenagers use crossing as an interactional resource to manage multicultural friendships, to Hill's description of the everyday racism embedded in the seemingly conviviality of mock Spanish, to the reappropriation of mock language by members of marginalized groups themselves, such as Chun's analysis of Margaret Cho's use of mock Asian. Online, offline, the negotiations of these multi-layered voices is complex enough, but online, with the affordances that TikTok provides for digital remixing, it becomes even more complex. We might make allowances, for instances, for the mock Asian used by creators like Stephen Vu.
Hello, welcome to the mail time.
What's up?
Lil, what are you doing here? I don't want to get my nails sharpie together.
The nail for the girl, what the heck you talking?
But how does the indexical meaning change when this sound is appropriated by members of other races?
Hello, welcome to the mail time.
What's up?
Lil, what are you doing here? I don't want to get my nails sharpie together.
The nail for the girl, what the heck you talking?
The fact that different forms of legitimacy are often granted to embodied and digital appropriations can be seen in the famous clip from Latinx TikTok drag queen Adam Ray, aka Rosa.
Dude, come here. You're gay. I fucking knew it, dude. You have like a boyfriend or what?
This clip was widely taken up and lip-synced by white gay male creators.
Dude, come here. You're gay. I fucking knew it, dude.
But it caused an uproar when the micro-celebrity James Charles animated Rosa's voice without the soundtrack, using his own voice.
You got a boyfriend or what? I am so cute. You know how I know? Because you be looking her up. You got a boyfriend.
This, of course, caused a kind of uproar. One user commenting, I hope you know making fun of Latinx accent like this is racist. I'm tired of his white ass profiting and making fun of people of color. Many of these questions about the authenticity and the appropriateness of voice appropriation and embodied stylization in TikTok have already been raised by sociolinguists in regard to other digital formats, as in Yanis Androsopoulos' special issue of Discourse, Context, and Media on negotiating authenticities in mediated times. For instance, where Kyoto and Westin write, digitally mediated interaction not only provides new means for sociality and intimacy, but also creates new complex layered combinations for the circulation of different inauthenticities and, importantly, meta-pragmatic evaluations of inauthenticities. And just as in the Facebook pages and YouTube videos and Twitter accounts that the scholars in this special issue examine, TikTok is also replete with meta-pragmatic commentary of people's stylizations. What I mean by metapragmatics is the way people talk about how we do things with words and whether or not we're doing things with words that are effective, sincere, polite, or appropriate. This metapragmatic commentary often comes in the form of duet videos in which people react to the videos of others, sometimes in mocking ways, as here. And also when people superimpose their own comments or text upon the videos of other people's performances. And sometimes you get these kinds of explicit admonitions or kind of pedagogical interventions.
Did you know in the 1820s, blackface appeared in minstrel shows to make fun of black people? And in 2020, it still exists, just digitally. Like when you're not black, but you talk like this. And when you're not black, but you act like this. And when you're not black, but you only use reaction pics like this. It doesn't really give you internet clout. It just makes you look weird and sometimes racist. Don't be weird or racist.
This metapragmatic commentary also can take on a kind of virality with debates about things like caucasity, a play on the word audacity, circulating through mimetic chains, just like the voice appropriations I discussed before. Here, a video of Brittany Broski, whom you'll remember as Kombucha Girl, responding to criticisms of her own practices of appropriation, is overlaid with textual critiques of what she's saying. And here is a video, of another creator who's responding to the controversy. But as with other digital platforms, questions of authenticities and inauthenticities, of appropriation and appropriateness are complex. And this is maybe even more so for TikTok, since appropriation seems to be the central raison d'etre of the platform. As Jason Parnham wrote in Wired magazine, TikTok is built by design on appropriation. The original lip syncing required users to mime existing audio. TikTok hinges on how imaginatively users can build upon something that's already there. It becomes all about the transformation. What sours this creative repackaging, what mutates the joy into hatefulness, is when the content is estranged from the original context, the way someone or something can so quickly and easily be warped, diluted, recast as something other, the way one's culture can be stolen and made monstrous or meaningless. As Gumbertz points out not long ago, the linguistic repertoires available to people to formulate messages in different contexts always come with certain rules and constraints, social etiquettes of language choice that need not just to be mastered, but also dynamically negotiated with other people in social interactions. In the case of synthetic embodiment, in which linguistic resources include these cut and paste snippets of other people's voices, these negotiations can be even more complex. Users of TikTok need to negotiate sets of constantly unfolding expectations about authenticity and etiquettes of appropriation. In the space between what Varis and Blommert call the floating and unfixed norm of enoughness, enough to produce a recognizable identity, enough at least to get likes, and the blurry line of not too muchness, with the performances in this space being constantly ratified and rejected by other users. This line, as Varis and Blommert write, is perpetually shifting and adjustable. What is enough today might be too much tomorrow. And what might seem to some people as acts of alignment or solidarity can so easily slide into symbolic violence. One thing that complicates this whole issue of voice appropriation on TikTok are the market forces governing the platform. The fact that in the attention economy of TikTok, these snippets of other people's voices take on not just indexical value, but also potentially monetary value. Most of the work on the commodification of language has focused on the values assigned to particular codes and styles, but in TikTok, it's people's actual voices that are turned into concrete commodities, whose value for the creator increases the more they're appropriated and circulated by other people as mimetic artifacts, requiring creators to regularly engage in what Abedin calls visibility labor. As, for example, when Korean boy and girl bands make available snippets of their songs for fans to lip sync to, or when people engage in intentionally provocative forms of appropriation or intentionally provocative acts of calling out other creators in order to boost their own visibility. Further complicating the way these fragile rules of appropriateness and authenticity are worked out, and why some practices of appropriation become sticky and others don't, is the entanglement of users' social interaction with the app's algorithm, which determines how and what kind of users see different kinds of videos on their For You page. The primary signal here is engagement, how long different people spend watching a video, but other signals are also taken into account, like the popularity of the soundtracks, hashtags, and captions. What's important here is that these signals are not just one way. Users become adept at appropriating discursive objects like the slogan Black Lives Matter, which they know the algorithm will pick up and push their content into more people's feeds until the content of those who have appropriated these resources starts to drown out more authentic voices. This has become particularly evident in the frustration that Black creators express when their content gets taken up by white creators, such as Charli D'Amelio, who inevitably end up getting the credit for it.
Y'all, I'm finna show y'all what the fuck is wrong with TikTok and why the fuck Black creators get so fed up. Like, this shit is so annoying, so fucking annoying. Just wait. So this is the girl who created the Savage Dance, right? You see how many likes she got? You see that? Okay, take note. Okay, let's click on the sound now. Of course, she's on top of me. She's doing what she do. She got that many likes, I mean, of course. And then you scroll down, you see, what do you notice? What do you notice? What do you notice? Y'all, I'm finna...
In thinking about how normativities around appropriation and authenticity are worked out within TikTok's assemblages of creators and audiences, voices and bodies, heavy and light communities and algorithms that push out particular semiotic configurations and constantly adjust and readjust their rules based on users' actions, I'm drawn to two concepts that Anna Doimert played with in a paper published in Language Sciences some years ago on practices of linguistic creativity on digital platforms in South Africa. Two concepts that attempt to bring the experientiality of creation and perception into sociolinguistic discussions of valuation. Semiotic negotiations of power and authenticity, Doimert argues, take place between the two poles of mimesis and mimicry. Mimesis is the affirmative creation of resemblances, the careful entrainment of voices with bodies, the fitting of the right voice with the right body, the celebration of the canny. Mimicry is the transgressive creation of disassemblance, the entanglement of voices with bodies in which they don't belong, the cringy, the dramatization of incoherencies, the camp, the queering of sameness as difference, the celebration of the uncanny, the unheimlich, the voice that is not at home. Neither of these poles are absolute. They're not a binary, but they overlap and they interact, producing different forms of identity and non-identity between object and representation. More importantly, the indexicalities they produce are not clear-cut. Acts of mimesis can, in some context, be just as disruptive as acts of mimicry. Where performances take place and where mutual understandings of authenticity and appropriateness are worked out is in the gap between the two. It is in this gap that the self is reimagined through the other, and the other is reimagined through the self. A couple of months ago, I came across a headline in the New York Times that declared everyone is gay on TikTok. The article talks about the trend on TikTok of young straight men to engage in homoerotic behavior with their friends. Partly, it seems, because such videos seem to get more likes and shares. There's even a name for this new normativity. It's called homosexuality. The article quoted a sociologist from the University of Roehampton arguing that this performance of inauthenticity is actually radically authentic. This generation's way of challenging the notion that someone would even be uncomfortable with them toying with the idea of being gay at all. Not surprisingly, this trend has attracted a raft of meta-pragmatic commentary, such as this video from Colton Hayes, the 32-year openly gay actor from Teen Wolf.
So all the straight guys out there who keep posting those is kissing the bros gay videos and laughing and making a joke of it. Being gay isn't a joke. What is a joke is you thinking you'd have any followers or any likes without us. So stop being fucking homophobic. So all the straight guys.
And also, not surprisingly, this soundtrack of this video was soon appropriated by other users.
So all the straight guys out there who keep posting those is kissing the bros gay videos and laughing and making a joke of it. Being gay isn't a joke. What is a joke is you thinking you'd have any followers or any likes without us. So
now what's interesting here is that in this appropriation, there is even not a trace of mimicry. That what seems to be most salient here is the kind of sincerity and authenticity in this appropriation. Another example of the political power of mimesis is based on a speech made by progressive Congresswoman Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez about the verbal abuse she suffered at the hands of a male colleague. This is from a speech that she gave in the US Congress.
About 2 days ago, I was walking up the steps of the Capitol when Representative Yoho suddenly turned a corner and he was accompanied by Representative Roger Williams and accosted me on the steps right here in front of our nation's Capitol. I was minding my own business, walking up the steps, and Representative Yoho put his finger in my face. He called me disgusting. He called me crazy. He called me out of my mind.
It didn't take long, of course, for this speech become a soundtrack on TikTok, where young women started to appropriate it into makeup videos, which also were interdiscursively linked to transformation videos like the Karma is a Bitch video that I showed you earlier.
Representative Yoho put his finger in my face. He called me disgusting. He called me crazy. He called me out of my mind. He called me dangerous. Representative Yoho called me, and I quote, a fucking bitch.
So what's interesting here is that what ends up being queered is not the voice, but rather the whole system of indexical expectations that support not just misogynistic violence like that Representative Ocasio-Cortez is describing, but also wider assumptions about femininity and authenticity. One of the creators who was part of this trend put it this way. She said, unlike Instagram, which is very static, all you see is the end result, which can be judged as superficial as women using makeup often are. TikTok shows the process, and you can layer over context on these audios. It reveals how complicated and multifaceted we actually are. And that is really empowering. In her insightful challenge for us to rethink the notion of the linguistic repertoire, Bridget Bush introduces the wonderful term Sprachenleben to refer to the lived experience of using linguistic resources, which takes us beyond simply acknowledging the normative power of language ideologies to expressing the bodily and emotional dimensions of language use as it creates complex positions of belonging and exclusion for speakers. Such an approach, she argues, is especially important in this era of geographical and technological disruptions, where people regularly move across and between multiple contexts and orders of indexicality, which raises the question, how does synthetic embodiment and the cut and paste linguistic resources it makes available to people affect the way people experience language and experience themselves? The contexts that Bridget focuses on are in some ways very different from those I've been describing, experiences of relocation where subjects find themselves in new linguistic environments, which simultaneously offer new opportunities for them to reinvent themselves and make them vulnerable to feeling that one's linguistic repertoire no longer fits with the environment in which they find themselves, which sometimes gives rise to confusion or shame. But there are also many similarities. The more I watch these videos on TikTok where voices are passed around, indexically polymorphous and playful, both transformative and deformative, creating personas that are full of cracks and transgress, merge, overflow, and destabilize boundaries, maybe the most profound sense I have is a sense of vulnerability. A sense that I think partly comes from the ethos of the platform itself, which celebrates goofiness and cringiness, partly from the vulnerability of creators who are constantly subject to evaluation from algorithms, from moderators, and from other creators, and partly from the vulnerability of these fetishized voices, which have no say in what bodies they end up in. At the same time, while appropriation is a central design feature of TikTok, so is reflexivity. The way it always draws attention to the performance of identity as an artifact, thus exposing the vulnerability of the notion of identity itself and the orders of indexicality that constrain it, potentially opening up for users a reflective space, a space of self-consciousness, not just for the performer, but also for the audience, where issues of appropriation and authenticity, privilege and racism come to the surface and come to be debated in sometimes creative ways. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Jones, for this invigorating and really enthusiastic talk.
Okay, thank you so much, Professor Rodney Jones. This has been a so much intriguing and insightful keynote speech, which is about language appropriation and multimodal the performance of the users of the video sharing platform to represent their ethics, ethnicity, their group communities. What is very, very, insightful to how, to understanding how we can create our own community by using language appropriation and transmodal practices, which gave so many different sort of insightful seeds into our research. Okay, so here are one of the questions from the audience, as I can read. As something made visible through media, it is immediately thought that it is common, stretching everywhere. So it is dangerous. It threatens, for example, white privilege in United States. Do you think that is Guy Debord right when he described our society as the society of the spectacle? If so, is it a superstructure or youth construct? It's based by themselves.
Okay, I'm just going to try to I wonder if I have access to the chat so I can read that question myself. I think I don't, so I'll just try to answer it from what I understood. Yeah, I think that visibility and the management of visibility is a really it's a really central issue around digital media now, not just the visibility of particular bodies and particular atrocities and particular social causes, but also the kind of everyday visibility that we need to manage as internet companies, for example, constantly surveil our activities, and the visibility that we need to manage with our friends and our followers. I think that invoking Du Bois is really apt, that digital media is very much all about the spectacle, all about the spectacle in some ways becoming much more important than the underlying issues. And this is actually something, it's an issue that's often debated on TikTok itself. How much do the forms of meta-pragmatic commentary, calling out, debating, and even the kind of creative spectacles that people create in response to, for example, racism and homophobia, how much are those actually perpetuating this this culture of the spectacle? How much of those actually are in danger of kind of trivializing the whole thing? And so, yeah, I think that's a very good point.
Thank you, Professor Rodney Joyce. Any other question? Because the chatting box is disabled. Any questions are welcome through with your microphone on.
We have the, sorry for the inconvenience. We have the chat box enabled for the internal users, but for the external users, it's not on. So you need to raise your hands and ask your questions through your microphones. Unmute yourselves, please. I have a question if no one has. Thank you again, Professor Jones, for this really engaging and illuminating presentation. First of all, I was curious how much time you spend on TikTok by collecting this data. It must have taken much of your time. I mean, you've been a professional TikToker then, right?
that's actually a very good question. One thing that almost everyone I talk to who is a user of TikTok or just a casual viewer of TikTok will mention is how addictive it is. And many of you who may be familiar with the platform also have this same kind of impression. And of course, this is what Natalie Shull calls addiction by design. That it very much is algorithmically driven, and so we are fed content that appeals to us. And the interface and algorithm of TikTok are really clever because TikTok can not just measure engagement, but it can also measure disinterest based on the kinds of videos you scroll through without watching. And so it is probably one of the best personalization platforms around. I do spend a lot of time on TikTok.
Yeah.
But the important thing about gathering data like this, and I think this is a very important point for scholars of social media as well, is that if I were just gathering data from my TikTok feed, it would actually be quite distorted. It would be data that's kind of personalized for me. And so I wouldn't be getting a kind of wide range of different kinds of content, because the algorithm would have narrowed that down rather quickly to things that it knows that I'm interested in. And so the way I've been handling this research is I've been employing student researchers who have been helping me and gathering videos that they think are interesting and relevant to the kinds of issues that I've talked about here from their own TikTok feeds. And I find that actually very, very interesting because, you know, we meet every other week and they come in and they talk about videos that they found that I've never seen on my feed, but which they say, oh, these are really famous videos, are really, these are memes, everyone is getting these, but I'm not getting them. So it is very important, I think.
It's customed. Personally customed, yeah. Sure. The algorithm is quite smart. Yeah, I get it.
And this customization can actually work against those of us who are doing research in this area, because sometimes I hear people talk about, oh, I did a Google search of this term, and you can see, you know, these are the top
related
10 hits, you know, as if everybody gets the same top 10 hits, but that's not. That's not actually the truth. I may do the same Google search and get a very different list of top 10 hits. So we do have to be especially careful of our own kind of algorithmic positionality when we're doing research of this kind.
Oh, I see. Oh, that's very informative. That's been so. It's quite different than Twitter. Twitter is kind of using different kind of way of collecting information so that we could see the most popular ones all at once, but the others, TikTok and the other searches, are different. I see. My second question is about pedagogy. I mean, you've offered us several ways of identity building. I mean, we can, many people, or particularly the Generation Z, they have multiple ways of building their identities. And how would this reflect in the classroom? I mean, how should a teacher deal with this multiple, various, and uncontrollable, arbitrary identities?
Okay. I don't think they're arbitrary, because I'm a sociolinguist and I don't think any identity is arbitrary. I think that identity are, you know, they're a matter of particular linguistic choices or semiotic choices more generally.
Yeah, you're right.
But I do think that the kinds of choices that these students have available to us are quite different from the kinds of choices that we had available to us when we were their age. Particularly these kinds of practices of synthetic embodiment that I've been talking about this morning, where they can go online, they can appropriate the voices of different people, they can use filters to change the way their face looks, they can do all sorts of kind of synthetically mediated kinds of identity work. And I think this is extremely interesting. There have been those who have found it troubling and disconcerting and disorienting, and I get that. I think that there is that. But I think, and one of the points I think I was trying to make in the talk, is that there's also another side, that this kind, these new opportunities for identity play also tend to facilitate a kind of reflexivity about identity itself. And, you know, I find that my students are really, really interested in talking about the kinds of issues that I'm, you know, talking about, for example, about whether or not using a particular voice is racist or not racist, or who's allowed to do this and who's not allowed to do this. And so these choices they make about personal identity when they're playing around with TikTok, which for many of us may seem to be a kind of, oh, a trivial kind of ludic activity, also connects them to big questions, you know, questions about racism and questions
of group identities as well.
Identities, exactly. And so I think this is actually really exciting and something that we can exploit in the classroom.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much. Well, yeah, I really appreciate your contribution. Thank you so much. Sanyong?
It's my pleasure.
Okay, so can we go on
yes.
about the question sessions? Okay, any other questions? Any questions are welcomed. Actually, I have a little bit of question. I want you to explain a little bit more about trans-pragmatic and trans-modal performances, because nowadays we are looking at so many conceptual issues about trans language, trans modal things like that. The ways I understand is trans modal is like something transcending different modes of digital communication and literacies, and the pragmatics is beyond just linguistic communication and pragmatic. So can you elaborate a little bit more about the difference between transmodal and trans pragmatics?
That's a very good question, and I think you're right that the whole kind of trans thing, we're living a kind of trans turn in applied and sociolinguistics. And I think that actually Li Wei's idea about translanguaging and the idea of translanguaging actually encompasses transmodal, trans-pragmatic, I sometimes call it trans-semiotic. It encompasses all of this. It's really a kind of perspective. I wouldn't call it a phenomenon because, you know, people have always, made use of a range of different semiotic resources when they're communicating. But it's a perspective. It's a new perspective on looking at them. And the important thing about this perspective is that this idea of correspondence, this idea of correlation and matching that linguists have for so many years been really obsessed with, you know, matching, doing things like syntax, doing things like multimodal interaction analysis and conversation analysis, where I'm going in there and trying to match a particular linguistic feature with a particular kind of social action. I think that what this is telling us is there are limitations to that. There are ways of people mixing languages, mixing semiotic resources, mixing even pragmatic intentions that are much more complex than that. I mean, even people like Austin and Searle talked about how when people are engaging in making speech acts, that sometimes they can actually make speech acts which have different illocutionary force for different listeners. So for example, a wife at a party might say to her husband, "Oh, it's getting late," and be creating a different speech act for her husband and a different speech act for the host of the party that she's attending. That's a kind of famous example that that Austin gives. And so I think you can also see it in the kind of transmodal stylization that we see on TikTok. When I first encountered it, I was really trying to make these correspondences, right? Saying, okay, so they're using these kinds of gestures, they're making these kinds of movements, they're wearing these kinds of clothes, and they're using this kind of voice. And how do they match together? And what you find is that often they quite radically don't match together. And this is also a point that Goodwin and Allen make about transmodal stylization, that it is actually possible to use different modal challenges to create contradictory, not complementary, but contradictory messages to create a kind of tension in your communication. And so I think in general, what we're what we're benefiting from this trans turn in language, is a kind of acceptance that that it's much more undeterminative and much more creative than kind of traditional theories of things like code mixing and even multimodal discourse analysis are really able to capture.
Okay, thank you so much. That is so much, I mean, the gave me so much the implications and insights to our research as the social linguist, because we are always thinking about our research should be a little bit limited to language analysis, things like that. But I think we can extend our research into other areas so that we can look at some, what is called trans languaging performances of the users, so that we can connect our research to the society in a broader sense.
Yes.
Hey, thank you so much. I think we can finalize our keynote speech session now. Thank you so much. And we have been very, very privileged to have you as a keynote speaker to this conference so far.
It was really my privilege to be here. I want to thank you once again for inviting me.
It's our honor to have you, Professor Jones, and we feel really privileged. Thank you for accepting our invitation, and I hope in the future we can meet in person and in person event, so that for the future gatherings.
I hope so too. Yes, I hope so too.
Thank you again.
Okay. Thank you all very much. It was very nice to see you this morning.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. We're finalizing the session.